Praise the Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so thankful for our young people. You know, sometimes you may not listen to a man preach, but how many could understand exactly what they were doing without any words being said at all?
Oh, yeah.
And you know what? That's real life. There's so much allurements and temptation. So many things that Satan put in our pathway every day to try to get us sidetracked. And I'll be honest with you, there are days that we get sidetracked. There's never a day that he doesn't long to be with us, that being Jesus, and come to our aid and rescue when we call upon his name. Amen? Praise God, praise God. Man, I've had church. Oh, to just turn you loose, let you do a Jericho march or two or three around this property. Show our neighbors that, hey, what we got ain't just in a building. Praise the Lord. It's in our life. It's who we are. But I couldn't do that because I like to preach too good. And you'd feel good, but I'd feel cheated. I won't keep you long. I've said that before a couple times too. But let me tell you something. Wherever the presence of God is, I don't care how long we stay. But when he lifts and the cloud clears and we no longer feel that exuberance, we can go get something to eat then somewhere. Then we'll come back and wait for him to appear again and bless us with his presence. But every time he comes like this, ladies and gentlemen, we need to be a thankful church, a grateful church, and honored that he would come and bless us and cause our feet to move in spite of our failures and difficulties, bad choices. Can I get an amen from somebody? Whoever you are and wherever you've come from today, God bless you for coming here. I pray that you've been blessed already and your needs have been met, your body's been healed, and with the list goes on. And we don't know what all God does in a service like this. In just a moment of time, he can touch and heal marriages that's been on the brink of falling apart for years, but in a moment of grace, in a moment of mercy, wham. One man asked me after service one night up in the mountains years ago, he said, man, what happened in that building tonight? This is what I told him. I was still drunk on the Holy Ghost. Man, I ain't kidding you. I was staggering around. He looked at me and said, what happened in that building, preacher? I said, I don't know. All I can tell you is this. Heaven kissed earth. And I got caught in between it. And I said, I don't know, but I got touched by God some kind of way. And I got healed. I don't know about you, but a while ago I felt heaven kissing the earth. And we were caught right here in this room, right in between it. His blessings in our life. Amen. If you have your Bibles today, I want you to turn with me to the book and the epistle of 2 Peter. 2 Peter. That's on page 1079. I tell stories often about my son. He was so comical coming up. I'll never forget that day. You've heard me tell it. He's trying to memorize a scripture. I said, where's it at? He said, I don't know, Daddy. I think it's in. I said, well, it sounds like it's maybe in 1 John. Is it 2 John? Is it 3 John? He said, no, I think it's regular John. I never forgot that. That was one of them moments. Praise God. 2 Peter. We drove up in the parking lot this morning, and I seen Brother Rod and Sister Lynn holding up the sign, Jesus is coming soon. And I thought, wow, that's interesting. I'm going to preach on Jesus is coming soon. I'm not kidding. That's where we're going this morning. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, are you ready? How many has watched the news lately? Before I start, let me do a CNN moment. How many has watched the news lately with all that's happening in North Korea and everything that's happening? Listen, folks, I'm not a big supporter of depression at all, never. Depressive information and news. But let me tell you something. As Americans and as children of God, you need to arm yourself with information. And you need to be aware of what's going on around you and what you need to do to combat that. There are spiritual forces at work, not just in America, not in our town, but in countries. And evil forces that are manipulating leaders, world leaders. It reminds me of the scriptures where God sent out evil spirits and and they went to the kings of the earth and convinced them to come down to the valley and to fight. Them same evil forces are with us today. And as close and closer that day comes as the appearing of the Lord, the second coming of Jesus Christ, the more we are hurled to that threshold of his coming, the more I think them spirits enhance their diabolical schemes to trick and connive in men and women around the world. They're not just interested in just a child of God. They know you love God, and they've got to go a long way to do that. But people to trip you up, you're public enemy number one to them. Yes, you are. Doesn't matter if you have a great title. If you're a child of God and you're born again and you're blood washed, he hates you. Are you aware of that? Say amen. He hates you. He doesn't like you. Because every time you look in the mirror in the morning, the Bible said you are made in the image. You are made as a human being. He made you in the image of himself. You are made in the image of God, in the likeness of God. Satan doesn't have that. I said Satan doesn't have that. Every time you look in the mirror and he sees you, you remind him of God. And he don't like God. Are you with me? Say amen. But there are forces in the world that are scheming and pulling great leaders together to summon them ultimately one day to a great battle. And that battle is called Armageddon. I'm not going to preach on Armageddon. It's a good subject, good topic. But I don't have time. I've got something else I want to give to you today. Before a lot of things take place, we're in the time that I believe Jesus describes. And I just told you to turn to 2 Peter, but would you turn to Luke real quickly, and then we'll go back to 2 Peter, because I want to build something here in your spirit about the coming of Jesus. Luke chapter 21. Luke 21, beginning of verse 25 through verse 28. When the majority of you have found Luke 21, verse 25 through 28, say amen and I'll begin reading. Hallelujah. There's a few still turning. I see pages and hear them. Luke 21, 25 through 28, and then we'll go back over to 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. So just kind of give you an idea where we're going. In case I get to talking and just go before you get there, then you'll know where to find your place. Luke 21, do you have it? Say amen. And there will be signs. Get this. I want you to listen to this. There will be signs in the sun and in the moon. When you read this, is it just that simple that things that we look at could be what Jesus is trying to say? Very simply, without going into a big theological debate. There will be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars. And on the earth, distress of nations. Hello. with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Hello, have you watched the Weather Channel lately? Hurricanes coming, seas is rolling, North Korea's gone crazy. Intercontinental ballistic missiles, nuclear capability. Said they could hit California on the East Coast now. They said possibly New York City, everywhere in between now, is vulnerable. Perplexities, distresses of nations, men's hearts failing them from fear and the expectation of the things which are coming on the earth. Hello, heart rate and heart failure and problems in people's lives and anxiety is at an all-time high. They're pushing pharmaceutical drugs like never before, and there's trillions of dollars of business and trying to keep people sane and anxiety-free and worry-free. He said in verse 27, then they will see the Son of Man in a cloud. How close are we? How close are we today, beloved of God? Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to happen, this is my thought today. He said to do two things. Look up. Look at your neighbor and say, look up. Anybody in here tired of looking down? I mean, I've been looking down a lot of my life too, along with everybody else, even though I have these great and exceeding precious promises. There are days that I wake up and I hear so much locally. Then I turn on the news and then I'm bombarded again nationally. Then I look and then spiritually I'm bombarded again. Satan says, you cannot win. You're alone. You're all alone. You're by yourself. I look at the odds that's stacked against the church, so to speak, that we're outnumbered by a horde of unbelievers and wickedness and spiritual wickedness in high places. Then I think about, hallelujah, the voice of Jesus. And I think about our lives and how he said to us, and these are very elementary verses that we learned early on in our walk with God. You should have. We learned that these words, as he quietly would tell us in a time of confusion and an interruption of peace in our life when we were at an altar early on. I remember the Holy Spirit speaking to me very simple, elementary words of Jesus that's been so profound in my life. They have kept me in many storms. He said words like this, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. I will go with you all the way even unto the end of the world. You need to remind yourself that though North Korea and though the worlds are in a, looks like a collision course with each other, and America is right in the mix of that, all of those things, our very existence as human beings is put on the table every day. Somebody that's radical could do something irrational and kill millions upon millions of people. There's germ warfare that could come at any moment and destroy more people by that way than they say nuclear capability could ever destroy or attempt to destroy. We're on the verge of being eradicated. But let me tell you right now, what looks to seem bad, hallelujah, when you look at it from God's point of view, ain't really that bad at all. And I just come by to tell God's people today in this house that's under the leadership of the Holy Ghost and under my leadership as your pastor, two words today. Look up, hallelujah, hallelujah to God. Look up, look up. And he says, and he gives the reasons why. He says, look up and lift up your heads because your redemption, somebody shout it loud, redemption. Whew, your redemption. Oh, your redemption draweth nigh. It ain't quite here, Jesus said, but it's here. It's closer today than it was last week. While you're doing your thing, it is drawing nigh. It is coming closer, closer, yet closer. Every day that we live, that's why Satan wants to sidetrack us. That's why he's trying to get all of us to go back into our old ways and do our old thing. To rechain us, to reshackle us, to re-imprison our lives so that we're not ready for the coming and the great day of the Lord. Hallelujah to his name. But I'm determined to be ready. I said, I'm determined to be ready. Sister Tracy said it earlier. Am I a perfect man? No. Are you a perfect? No. But I know this. I'm forgiven. I'm forgiven. I'm blood washed. My name is in a book where Satan cannot go in and erase it out of that book. I am forgiven. And grace has done a marvelous work in our life. And the least we can do is look up. The least we can do is be ready and look up, because our redemption draw if nigh. I don't have time, but redemption is a great word to be redeemed. Am I right? Help me, Brother Rod. It says it literally means exorazo. Am I right about that? Be redeemed. It means to be bought back. It means to be, the Greek for that is exorazo. It means to be bought out of. And in this case, if you track it back so far, it's literally being bought from the slave market. Literally. That's what it means. To be bought out of slavery, out of bondage. In other words, I want you to get this picture just for a minute. The reason we keep looking up is because one day we were all tied to the whipping post of life. And we would sit there as slaves to Satan and to sin. Now, are you with me, good people? Say amen. And as we were there, we were told to do such and such, and we did that because, not because we liked it. We liked it when we started it, but after we got in it, we didn't like it no more, but we couldn't stop it. I said we couldn't stop it. Sin had done had its way with us. We was on a course for destruction, and we could not stop it. We wanted to, but our flesh was, it was stronger than our will to live and to make rational decisions. And thus we still became tied and chained to the whipping post of life. And any time that Satan wanted to buffet us and beat us down and discourage us and to throw us down, he could do that at his leisure. But I'm going to remind everybody under the sound of my voice what them teens was telling you, and them young people were telling you a while ago with no words. I'm going to tell you with words. When Jesus came, the hordes of hell are trying to get us back. But he took Hallie over here, Chris did a while ago, and showed her the cross. The Bible said through it, he made a show of them openly. And he spoiled principalities and power through it. Through the cross that he was raised upon. But then that day came. 3 days. There is no one in the tomb. He is alive. Now not only is the sacrifice of sin accepted in the heavenlies, but now the solidness of that sin being forgiven has now manifested in the resurrection of Jesus. See, without the resurrection, the cross means nothing. But because he died, he rose again to secure what he died for. Are you with me? Shout hallelujah to God. If Paul said, if we preach that Christ is alive, if he is not risen, then our faith is in vain. What you believe in, what you sing about, is in vain. It is nothing. It is more nothing more than a fairy tale. But the tomb is empty, and faith is alive, and Jesus is coming. So look up. Hallelujah to God. And that day, while you was tied to the post of life, and the auction was going on, and Satan says, they ain't worth nothing. I bid a dollar. Who'll give me a dollar and a quarter, a dollar and a quarter? Who'll give me a dollar and a half, and a dollar and a half? Sin said, I'll give you a dollar and 15 cents. Satan said, I'll make it a dollar and a quarter. We lay in there saying, oh my God, I got to be worth more than that. Come on, somebody. Our self-esteem is drained because of sin. Our go ye, our choices is confused. We don't know what to do. Our worth, that's one of the greatest battles I deal with, but people fighting them, is their self-worth and their feeling of being someone again, being challenged, being loved, being forgiven. Are y'all with me? Say amen. That's a tough thing when you've been beat down all your life. You've been succumbed to sin. You don't know no other way. Your arms is tracked up with needle scars, and you took so many drugs, it's altered your mind. Are y'all with me? Say amen. You've been in an abusive situation. You've been in a home where you've been beat and hurt, and everything has been destroyed. It's something when Jesus, hey, and here's the thing. This is why you got to look up. It's because that day when no one would give you anything for your life, your soul, your future, it was all over. Jesus steps up to the auction block, and the devil says, I'll give you a dollar and a half. Jesus said, I'll give you my blood, which, by the way, is worth more than silver or gold. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You was not redeemed by silver or gold. According to the book, Jesus didn't come write a check for you. He come, gave his life. I talked about this last week, substitution. This is what we don't understand. He didn't just come by you back and say, come home with me. He went over to the whipping post, unshackled your hands, and told sin, you can have me. And for 6 hours one Friday, they beat him when I should have been. They tortured him. They plucked his beard out. They spit upon him. Come on, somebody. And the Bible said, I tell you right now, he wasn't from Globeville. How you know that? Because the Bible said he opened not his mouth. Globeville boys don't go somewhere. You beat on them, spit on them. We open our mouth up. Y'all hearing me? I tell you right now, that was a different man. I can tell you right now, he wasn't just an ordinary man. He was a God man. He was the Son of Man. He was the Son of God. And he paid that debt so that your head wouldn't have to hang down on days like we're having, when CNN says it's all over and Fox News says get ready. Jesus says, look up. Hallelujah to God. Look up. Does that sound all right to somebody in here today? Look up. You've been looking down long enough. Touch your neighbor and say, you've been looking down long enough. It's time for you to look up. Matter of fact, if I had a good subtitle for this message, besides look up, it'd be this. Change your view. I don't like looking at the rocks. I like looking at the sky. Because let me tell you right now, the earth, according to God's rule of back into with man, has been cursed because we made bad choices. It's not going to yield what it should have yielded. But I ain't looking at the ground. I'm looking at the sky. They put dead folk in the ground. I'm planning on living, and I'm planning on leaving. So I'm looking at the sky. Let me preach a minute. Your redemption, your full purchased, the purchasing agent of Jesus Christ is coming to pay off the entirety of his church and debt and remove them. Now, you have an earnest, the Bible says, of this inheritance. An earnest means down payment. Are y'all with me? Y'all heard me talk about this. Down payment. It's a deposit. It's what we call the layaway program. When you got saved, you didn't go to heaven. Heaven came to you. You didn't go to it. It came to you. Inside of you, when you got saved, born again, and filled with the Holy Ghost, he deposited heaven in you. Did all of heaven get in you? No, couldn't hold it all. You'd explode. We'd have to have Serpro come in here and wipe the walls down. That's why you can't handle so much in your earthly body, in your mind, because you can't understand all the vastness of His glory. Are you with me? So He puts enough in you so you can do what you did here this Sunday morning right in the face of the devil and your problem and your sickness and your difficulty. Shout, children, because you got an earnest of your inheritance inside of you. Shout, beloved of God, because you have a down payment of God's blessed love inside of you. But one day, this is what Satan don't want you to know. One day, the one who deposited that in you is coming to collect. When you lay away something for Christmas, you usually do it when? October. You don't do it the day before Christmas. Hello. Usually around July, August. Them youngest has got the books out. I want one of these, one of them, two of them. Them's $300. That ain't nothing, Daddy. Get them anyhow. Okay, what else? Well, five of them will do. Some of them, some of that, some of them. And if you got room left, a couple of these. And you know what we do as parents? We don't say, you ain't getting nothing. You've been bad all year long. Sack of coal and bag of switches is what you need. This is a Christmas message in August. No, you know what we do? Because we love our children. Because we love them, we'll go down there and stand in a line with all the crazies. We get up to the counter and we say, putting all this, they know what we're doing. Putting all this on layaway. I'm trying to tell you and teach you something spiritual here. We're putting all this on layaway. Then it comes to this. They tally it all up. Well, sir, that comes to a grand total of $1,872.32. And you say, my God, I got to call my boss, tell him I need some overtime. Take care of that. Then the person over there says, we require. In order for us to keep this safe, so that somebody else can't buy, it can't be bought. Once somebody's done made a down payment on it, it's took off the shelf. And the shoppers, cause sin and lust and everything else, can't buy you cause you done got a down payment on you. And you get back in and they tape that thing up. You know, they put saran wrap around or something and they get it all together and they bundle it. And then they write your name on it. And they say, you can get this out by the 24th. Now you know the day you're going to get that out. But only He knows the day He will come get us. And one of these days what He has laid away and made a deposit in. Redemption is the word that says, I am coming to retrieve it all. And if they think 10%, because here's my theology. If I give God, what did God require man to give? Come on, somebody. 10%. I feel like God, when He gives us an earnest, I feel like He'd break His own rule if He didn't give a tithe back to us. So I believe what we have is only a tenth of the 90 that's coming. So here's my thought. If the 10 makes me laugh, shout, dance, skip, run, fight the devil and have the victory. What do you think's going to happen when he says, children, you've been living with the ten. Look up. I dare to shout, look up. Hallelujah. Look up, children. The rest of it's coming. The rest of it's on the way. You think this is something. You wait till he comes back and gives us, hallelujah, the rest of what he has promised all of us. That'll be a day when you're glad you're on the layaway program of heaven. Look up, your redemption. Your redemption draweth nigh. But there are some things in life that shake us. Can I read a few things to you? Found some stories that date all the way back, get this, to 1666. Ain't it interesting that the last three numbers coincide with the mark of the beast? Christians can get crazy sometimes when numbers start lining up. In 1666, a rumor spread through England that the world would end that year. The conclusion was drawn from certain biblical students relating the mark of the beast to that particular year. As the rumor spread, more and more people, royalty alike, lived under a sense of impending, the story says, impending disaster. During the summer of 1666, a violent storm arose in western England. As Sir Matthew Hale presided, this is a judge now in the courtroom at the year of 1666. Sir Matthew Hale presided as judge in his courtroom. A lawyer present at the present day wrote this note as the scene began to change. He said, all of a sudden, the courtroom grew completely dark, though it was still midday. Then the entire courtroom seemed to shake as peals of thunder shook the wall and bright flashes of lightning illuminated the room. People inside the courtroom were overcome with fear. And he says that if by a common consent, each fell to his knees and prayed to God for mercy, believing that the terrible day of the Lord had arrived, as some had said. The lawyer noticed, however, that Judge Hale sat unmoved by the storm. He continued to take notes of the trial as though nothing out of the ordinary was happening at all. The lawyer concluded and found out later that Judge Hale's heart was so stayed on God that no surprise, however sudden, could discompose him at all. I don't care what happens. Our heart should be fixed. Hey, if this is the end, then bring it. Hallelujah. But if it's not, give me stickability and stability in my life. That, like Paul said, none of these things move me. Can I get an amen from somebody? None of these things move me. Oh my. The second coming of Christ is the ultimate hope for the world. Turn 2 Peter quickly. The second coming of Christ is the ultimate hope of the world. Your ultimate hope ain't a new husband or a new wife, a house at the lake, a Cadillac, a BMW, a Porsche, Mercedes, Corvette, Harley Davidson. Ooh, I'm hitting in my area now. If I'm going to hit you, I might as well hit me. Big tract of hunting land. Oh, God, I can't believe I said that. That is not my hope. My hope is the soon appearing of Jesus Christ. Our Lord, let's look at 2 Peter real quickly and I'll finish. But the day of the Lord will come, verse 10. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come. Somebody shout, it will come. Let's all just be on the same page with that. It will come. How will it come? As a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise. The elements will melt with a fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in will be burned up. Therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conduct and godliness? Paul Peter says this simply. He said, if you know he's coming and you know what's going to happen when he comes, if you know that that's about to take place and you're on the very threshold of it, then what kind of conduct should you have in your life? How should you be living every day of your life? What kind of standard of holiness and purity should you be possessing in your life? Hello. If we're that close to the coming of the Lord, how should we be living? Come on, somebody. Should we be living as loose as we can? Or as tight as we can get our arms around God and His around ours? Oh, yes. Looking for and hastening the coming of the day of the Lord, because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. And I keep hearing all this stuff about global warming and the sea's going to rise. It's going to flood again. Ladies and gentlemen, your problem ain't water. Our problem is going to be fire next time. He won't drown the society in water. He done proved he can do that one time. The next time he decides to judge the entire earth, it won't be droplets of agua coming down out of the sky. It will be fire coming. Somebody shout, I'm looking up. Okay, let's read on. Nevertheless, we according to his promise, I like this, here's the word. Anybody see that four-letter word, look? We look. Everybody that's got something from God is always looking. If you're a praiser, you're looking. If you're born again, you're looking. Are you sanctified, you're looking. If you got the Holy Ghost, you're looking. If God's done something in your life, you ought to be looking. Hallelujah. Looking up. Looking for something. Looking here, he said, for new heavens and a new earth. I like this. In which righteousness dwells. Sin is gone. Satan is bound. Righteousness dwells. Hallelujah. The second of coming to Christ is the ultimate hope of the world. Give me just a few seconds. The question arises, not just when will he come, or if he comes, why will Jesus come? Why will Jesus come back? Christ will return to rapture his people. Simple as that. He's coming to rapture his people. He's coming to get us. He's coming to get what he loves the most. Before the great tribulation period and the emergence of the Antichrist kingdom, Christ will snatch his people from the earth. In the words of the great apostle, hallelujah, we will be caught up together in the clouds to meet the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 4 and 16. Second reason, Christ will return, I like this, to rule the world. Won't be no votes. Won't see a bunch of Democrats and Republicans and bipartisan folk frailing around like they ain't got no sense. I'd be so glad when our world is purged from the evil. One man told me one time, he said, you know what? Mean old guy. He said, you know what? I'm about tired of all this church. You know, you ever met somebody act like they just got through dating a jar of pickles? And then kissed them long and hard before they went inside. Nothing suits them. Nothing's good enough. Man. I don't like all that church stuff, preacher.
Matter of fact, I'm tired of all them holiness people. He said, I wish I could go somewhere where there ain't none of them holiness people. You know what I told him? I said, try hell. There ain't many of them there. Tell you that right now, son. I said, all of us that's living right and pure, we going to another location. Now, if you've been on going where there ain't a whole lot of church folk, then make your reservation there. He went back to eating pickles. There's some folk you can help in life, and there's some folks you can't help in life. Touch your neighbor and say, look up. Don't talk to the pickle eaters. Look up. Don't worry about them. Just keep looking up. When Christ returns, he will return to remove all evil. Let me go back to rule the world, though. Christ will return in triumph and glory at the battle of Armageddon to rule as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Read it in Revelation, I believe it is 19. Christ will return to remove evil. Hallelujah to God. Jesus will rule the world with his people during the millennial reign. Then the millennium will end with the final destruction of Satan at the great white throne judgment according to Revelation 20. Satan and his hordes. The Antichrist and the false prophet, according to the Bible, not popular magazines, according to the Bible, they shall be cast alive into the lake of fire. Are y'all with me? Say amen. It's over. It's done. It's done. It's done. The last time somebody got drowned in a sea, I heard somebody on the other shore over there that told the Israelites, take a good look, because your enemies that you see today, you will never see them again. Let me tell you right now, he drowned Pharaoh's army in the Red Sea. He's going to take care of Satan and his horde in the red fire of hell. And when they go down, ladies and gentlemen, that's when we rise up and we will never have to deal with him again. That ain't what I said. That's what the Bible says. And I don't have time to go into it all. The last thing he will do, he will return to restore all things. The Bible ends with a vision of a new heaven and a new earth. Revelation 21. Read it, I think it is, verse 1 through 7. What God started in Genesis, he completes in Revelation. The earth will return to its original condition as it was on the day of paradise when no sin had entered. Oh, my. When no sin had yet come through the disobedience of the first two human beings that were here, who I want to talk to real long and hard when I get to glory. I want to get both of them together at the dinner party and say, what would you think? Then I'm going to look at Adam and say, you should have stopped Eve from going shopping that day. You should have told her, you ain't leaving the house. Come on, somebody. And since that day, we've been battling and dying and diseased and hurting ever since. Can I get an amen? But I'm talking about looking up that Jesus is coming. And it ain't just going to be a show into heaven. He's going to make it right once and for all. Not just in the world, but in our bodies and in our lives with our family. Hallelujah. And forever we shall be with the Lord. Ain't that a beautiful thought? Preachers are telling me I need an extra car and I need an extra this and I need one of them. No, what I need is for heaven to come down and invade the earth. What I need, hallelujah, is to stay rapture ready and looking up, hallelujah, because at any minute my redemption could get right here at the threshold. I'm telling you, I hear a cry going out through our land. Oh yes, it's a cry of revival, but it's also a cry that's saying to the church, get ready, Jesus is returning and he's coming soon. Stand on your feet. Hallelujah.